Let me first introduce myself. I used to work at Google. I ran my startup FutureCam for a few years. I then worked as CTO of a startup. Now I work as a part-time CTO, as a consultant, working with multiple companies. Today I wanted to talk to you about a cool hack in the FutureCam codebase. And let me just show you what FutureCam is. This is a website, you can play with it. I'll put a link in the description. And this is an interactive website, you can play with these sliders. So this is an advanced computational photography app. And some of these features work by taking multiple photos and then combining them together to create an output. Right? Capturing multiple photos, one output. Output can be a photo or a video, but the input is multiple photos, right? It's called multi-frame technique. So this is what we need to do for our algorithms in FutureCam. Now, unfortunately, on the iPhone, when you take a photo, Apple's API makes a clicking sound for you, right? You don't want that necessarily. You want one clicking sound for the entire capture. Because I have seen users get confused by multiple click sounds, multiple shutter sounds. They thought multiple photos are being taken, it's a burst mode, and they stopped it, saying I want only one photo. No, it's just one photo that internally is implemented by taking multiple photos and combining them together. So it takes a while, right? And the user wants to hear only one click. Now, only one shutter sound. Because that is the mental model, right? And mental models are very important in UX. Something may be implemented in a certain way, but the user thinks of it in one way, right? For example, Google Drive, you see the icon on the desktop here. The mental model is, it's a folder, you put things into it, it'll sync. The implementation is different, right? It involves whatever, various servers, various network protocols, all that stuff. You don't need to know. The user has a mental model. Similarly, in a car, the mental model is if you press the accelerator, the car will go faster. How does it do that? In a petrol car, there'll be more petrol and correspondingly more air entering the combustion chamber. In an electric car, more electric power is sent to the motor. But users don't need to understand this implementation model. They have a mental model, which is their idea of how it works. And software needs to conform to the user's mental model, otherwise they won't be able to use it. For example, a button. The mental model is you click it, something happens. If you have a button that cannot be clicked, it will seem buggy. So that's why mental models are important, and we need to spend a lot of time to preserve the mental model. In this case, we need only one shutter sound. iOS gives you multiple, and it doesn't have an API to disable it. So we came up with this really cool hack. Where iOS has a sound file for each of the system sounds, right? Normally the way this API is supposed to work is you're supposed to allocate a sound, use it, and then dispose it. In this case, what we are doing is somebody figured out on Stack Overflow, and I've just reused the hack, but it's a cool hack nonetheless, I'm sharing it with you. Just before iOS captures a photo, it invokes this callback saying will capture photo. At that very instant, we deallocate the sound file, and then iOS tries to play the sound and there's no sound file available. So the shutter sound doesn't play. Normally, we're not supposed to do this. We are supposed to dispose something we have allocated. But here we are reaching in and disposing something that iOS has allocated, forcing it to remain silent. So this is a cool hack. And in many sophisticated programs, there will be such hacks. As far as possible, you should avoid them 95% of the time, say. Like lack of knowledge, lack of attention to detail, lack of time. Those are not good reasons to put in hacks. But if something is the only way possible, then by all means put in a hack, right? And you will have very few such hacks in an app. That's okay, right? I mean, if 50% of your app is hacks, that's a problem. But if you're not using any hacks at all, even when necessary, and sacrificing functionality or confusing users, that's also a problem, right? So you should use these hacks judiciously. As engineers, especially good engineers, we have a voice in our head telling us don't do this. And 90% of the time you should listen to that voice, but 10% of the time or 5% of the time you should override that voice. Another way of looking at it is it's a trade-off between code quality and UX quality. And UX quality is what matters. People will rather buy a BMW containing a Tata Nano engine than a Tata Nano containing a BMW engine, right? People buy what's on the surface, the UX. If it is polished, if it works the way they want, they'll think it's a good app. Otherwise, they'll think it's bad. That's how users judge, not by the code quality. So anyway, so just wanted to share this with you. If you like me to help your team with code quality or other aspects, there's a link in the description. And that link will tell you how we can work together if you're interested. Thank you.